welcome to the show called Habitat. Welcome to the show called Habitat, a show about wildlife, habitat, and the environment. And in order to avoid litigation, Lois, our co-host, will read the liability release.
Everything seen on this Habitat show is from information gathered or received and is not necessarily the opinion of BCTV and or the members of our Environmental Action Committee. Nothing portrayed herein is for profit or prestige. All the above captioned includes anything and everything forever and a day.
Excellent. And sitting next to you is Nancy Wisser, and she's an author. And after our call-in guest, she's going to talk to us about her book. And then we have Alan Hoppus, the co-creator of the Maiden Creek Watershed Association. I'm the other guy that created it. And if you can last through the show, you'll hear Alan talk. So now we're ready to talk to our call-in, Dr. Chris Rosenberry, head of the Deer Department of the Pennsylvania Game. Chris, can you hear me? Pennsylvania Game Commission. Hello. Aha, that's the first. Oh, all right. Can you hear me now? Is he on there? All right. You read that thing?
Yeah.
So, Alan.
Mr. Paulus, are you looking for me?
Yes, Chris.
Yes.
All right, we're ready to show the pictures and hear what you have to say about GPS deer location technology. Did I get it right?
Yes. We'll be talking a little bit about GPS collars and how we use them here in Pennsylvania for deer research purposes.
Good. And can we see a picture? Okay. Yeah, what's that, Chris?
I assume you're showing the photo of me holding a fawn?
No, it's the picture number one. It looks like four people with...
Okay. Right. So what we have there is a photo of a capture crew with a newly captured fawn. And here in Pennsylvania, in the last 20 years, we've completed two fawn survival studies. Some of those studies were located in north central Pennsylvania, above Interstate 80. Others were located in central Pennsylvania near State College.
Okay, now we'll go to the next picture. And that would be picture number two, Chris. So if you want to start, tell us about it.
Okay.
A bear.
Right, so predators were really part of the motivation for both of the fawn survival studies we did here in Pennsylvania. Hunters were concerned about the impact of predators on the deer population, wanted us to estimate and look at fawn survival as a result of predator populations increasing and expanding in Pennsylvania. So the first project took place in 2000 and 2001, the most recent project in 2015 and 2017, and these were projects that we did collaboratively with the Pennsylvania Cooperative Fish and Wildlife Research Unit at Penn State, as well as the Game Commission deer biologist and biologist aides. So in order to look at this effect of predators on fawns, we went out, we captured fawns, and in some of these cases, particularly the most recent project, we used some of these newer technologies to track and as well as find fawns.
So there's the GPS collar on the deer in, of this picture with the girl, right? And the
right.
Larger deer?
Right. So that's a doe with a fair amount of high-tech equipment on her. The collar that you see there is a GPS collar. That collar will collect that deer's location using GPS satellite at regular intervals. Those collars also, once they've collected a number of locations, they will send a text message to us with those locations. We can also send a text message back to that collar telling it to take locations more often or less often. During the hunting seasons, for example, we may collect locations every 20 minutes. During the other parts of the year, we may collect locations every few hours.
Oh,
but in
good.
The case of...
Uh-huh. Go ahead. Let's try another picture.
Yeah.
Oh, is that it? It looks like a blue thing with a red and a wire.
Right.
What is that?
Going back to that doe with that collar, she not only has a collar around her neck, she also has one of these, which is called a vaginal implant transmitter. It's a transmitter that was inserted into the birth canal of the doe during capture, and then when the fawns are born, that transmitter is expelled during the birth.
Wow.
The GPS collar can also pick up that transmitter and send us a text message saying the VIT has been expelled. This was the time it was expelled. It will also give us the coordinates of when that, of where that VIT was expelled, which will give us an idea of where the birth site was. We'll wait a few hours, and then we will go in looking for those fawns.
And
so the GPS collar combined with this technology allows us to try and find fawns within the first day following their birth.
Wow. Interesting. And what's the next picture, Chris? Oh, all right. I see it. It's in the lower right-hand corner. It's just the same thing we saw before. It was expelled, and it's there?
Yes. This is an actual birth site. So the location of this birth site would have been sent to us, like I said, via a text message with those coordinates. Our crews would go in. This is what they would find at these VIT sites, and as you can see, there's no fawns visible in that photo. So once they had that starting point, from there they would begin circling out looking for fawns.
And what's next? What's next? Oh, that's you. Is that what you look like? Okay. Oh. And that little fawn hat is all wired up then. Is that correct?
Yes. Yes. So that is one of the fawns that was captured during our most recent project. And you can see that he has ear tags in his ears. Those are numbered ear tags.
Wow. He'll
stay with the deer for the remainder of its life. In fact, we've had trail cam photos sent in to us of adult does, and with those ear tags in it, we've gone back and looked, and they were from the original fawn survival study 14 years prior to that trail cam photo. So those ear tags will basically identify that deer for the rest of its life. And you can see the fawn collar around its neck. That collar will allow us to track its movements. It'll send out a signal that we can track with our receiving equipment. It also will tell us if the fawn has died and or been killed and is no longer moving. And at that point, we can home in on the collar, recover the fawn, and then take it to our wildlife veterinarian for a necropsy to try and determine the cause of death. And
one other thing about those
collars, you can see that there looks like there's folds in it there on the side of the fawn, looks like three individual pieces. That's to allow that collar to expand as that fawn gets older, neck grows, the collar will expand to accommodate that growth.
Very nice. What's the next one? It's a fawn laying there, curled
up. So I think I may have sent you two photos of fawns laying there on the forest floor.
That's the
oftentimes album. What we find.
Yeah, you got them both. And what are they doing there? They're just hiding, I guess, or what?
They are just hiding. When newborn fawns will use a hider strategy where they will just lay still, hoping that any sort of danger just passes by without seeing them. So oftentimes this is how we find them. If you find them like that and they don't lift their heads up, they're going to be an easy capture. You just reach down and can pick them up. In these photos, you see the coloration of the fawn and how it, you know, the variations in the color of the fawn sort of match the variations there on the forest floor in terms of the leaves.
Excellent. Now, if you have one more picture for us?
I think that's the
last one. Is that the last one?
Yeah.
Okay, good. So
if I could, regarding the fawn laying there, one part of a, I guess maybe a public service announcement part of the program here.
Uh-huh.
Every summer, people find fawns just like this.
Right.
And all we would say is don't pick them up. Just because a fawn is there by itself, you do not see a doe, doesn't mean the doe is not around. As part of this research, we had collars on the does, we had collars on the fawns, and those GPS collars on the does also could tell us when the fawn was close to the doe. And the first few weeks of life, 60 to 70% of the day, a doe is not close to her fawn.
Wow.
So, we would encourage people, if you find a fawn laying out there, just let it alone. Whether you see the doe or you don't see the doe, please just let them where they are. They do not need rescued. In fact, they're just doing what deer do.
Oh, thank you so much, Chris. That sounds like a good way to sign off. And we very much appreciate your being on the show and giving us that important message. And we hope that you'll be able to come in another show. Thanks again, Chris.
All right, you're welcome.
Bye. Now, deer are so pretty. Look at this beautiful deer here. It's this was given to us by the Crumsville Vintage Shop in Crumsville, up on Old Route 22 and 737. It's just so graceful and nice. I don't know if you can see it. Yeah, here it is. All right. Now, moving right along, Lois and Nancy.
Mm-hmm.
Take it away.
Nancy Wisser is an author. She has a chapter in a book titled Greening the Paranormal, Ecology of Extraordinary Experience. The editor is Jack Hunter. Can you tell us basically what is this book about?
Sure. And first I want to thank Matt and everybody for having me on. The book is about everything from plant intelligence and childhood mystical experience all the way to alien abduction and psychedelics. But it's all how they're related to nature. To boil it down to its meaning, as far as I'm concerned, I'll quote one of the authors, Lance Foster, who says, "There is no such thing as the paranormal. The things we call paranormal or supernatural are normal and natural."
Wow.
These concepts really rise from basic misunderstandings that our culture has about what nature, the land, and the planet really are.
Wow. Oh, wow. Maybe you could focus on the picture that we have on the table there.
The book.
Let's see. And that's the book.
That's the book. It's just coming out this week, by the way. You can find it on Amazon or Barnes & Noble, I believe. And it should be sent out within a week. But this is the first week that it's available.
Very nice. And Lois, you have another question?
Mm-hmm. Your chapter is titled, This Moment Returns to Me, Childhood Reverie and a Lenape Idea of Recruitment by the Earth. Can you tell us what it's about?
Yeah, and this is an example. Some of these ideas in this book are very familiar to some people, but we know that a lot of people aren't as familiar with them. My chapter is a story about what happened to me after a descendant of the Lenape people, and this is their sacred homeland here in eastern Pennsylvania, told me that they believe that people who work for the earth were recruited by the earth. And at first it seemed like nonsense to me. The whole essay is over a succession of research and realizations, I came to see that not only were they talking about something real in my life, but I was able to go back through literature in Western civilization and even some of the other arts and find examples of this happening. It just was something that was elusive but was out there to be collected. I'm very honored to be part of the book.
Wow.
And what would you expect people to take away from reading this book?
Well, I think the main message is that you can't understand the world as long as you ignore whole categories of reality, whole categories of people's real experience. I've spoken to many, many people who, even people who say at first, oh, nothing like that ever happened to me. After a while, you talk to them and they start saying, oh, well, really, after my father died, this bird started coming to my window or something like that. Or when we put my father's urn up outside at his outdoor funeral, butterflies started flying around it. I've heard so many of these stories, and I've had people who said they didn't have any come back to me later and say, oh yeah, I remember when I was a child, I was standing in a field and suddenly it was like something was speaking to me, you know? I think that the fact that our culture throws these examples out and encourages people to just ignore the fact that they exist, mm-hmm. it means that we come to a point where we don't really understand the world. And I think that basic misunderstanding of what the world and nature, the land and the planet is behind some of the environmental problems that we're having. If we could include this data in our understanding of what the world is, we would be better able to understand how to fix it and also how to act. It would actually change the way we act toward it if we understood what it really was.
Wonderful.
Wow. Wow. Is that it? Right, do you have one more question?
I don't, but I'm very
nice.
Anxious and interested in ordering the book.
Yes, please look into it. If somebody wants me to send them a sample chapter, write to Matt, and I can copy up a chapter for somebody or the introduction, which is really fascinating, and let them read it, and then they can decide whether they want to read the book.
And you're Nancy Wisser, right?
Wisser, I know. In the book, it says Nancy Wissers with an S at the end, but that's just a misprint.
You have a brother who was the attorney for Alan and I.
My maiden name is Lar, and my brother David, or his nickname was Zeke Lar, was involved with you and Alan years ago.
Well, Zeke and Alan and I remember like it was just, how long ago was it, Alan?
It's about 20 years, more or less.
20 years. Does it seem like just yesterday?
Sort of, yes.
Sort of. Well, and we created the Maiden Creek Watershed. And why do they call it the Maiden Creek, I wonder, do you know?
That was the Americanization or the Anglicization of the Ontolani. It was just,
Ontolani meant little sister of the Schuylkill.
Oh. And also, Alan, you are organizing trips, environmental trips, and natural history trips to Europe, Portugal
and Spain. So in Portugal, I'll be collaborating with the Schuylkill County travel writer, Cindy Ross. She'll be bringing a group over. We'll be doing hiking and biking trips in Portugal. That's the first one in October. And then in April of next year, we're looking for people who are interested in a birding trip that will be in the Doñana National Park in southern Spain. That will be, we're working with Hawk Mountain Sanctuary now to get people who are interested in a birding trip with a former trainee from Hawk Mountain Sanctuary.
So let's say somebody wants to go on what it sounds like a very interesting and exciting excursion. What number would they call?
Well, I'm not so much a number as a website, and my website is I Like You Tours, and that name came about with I Like You Want to Live in a World of Peace. I Like You Know That Dialogue is Better Than Fear. So my website is www.ilikeyoutours.com.
Wow. And you'll be heading it or organizing it?
I'm on most of the trips, not all of them, but I'm on most of the trips.
Wonderful. Now, does anybody have anything interesting or otherwise to say before we sign out?
What about you, Matt?
What about
Can
you Matt?
Remember a childhood experience in nature that helped to engross you in nature and become such a lover of nature?
No, but I have some cryptozoology things to tell you. You know, tell the people what cryptozoology is.
Cryptozoology is the study of animals that are, maybe stories are told of them, but they haven't been verified by science.
So people in northern Berks County, we're in Berks County, Berks County TV, about once a week people call and say they see an animal they cannot identify, they never heard of before. Very unusual cryptozoology animals. And we have some pictures and so on of them. Can you tell us more about a little bit about that?
Well, I can't speak to those. I haven't seen the pictures, but I do know that when I spoke with some of the Lenape people, they told me that Sasquatch, or whatever the other names are, was a being who walked between the worlds and was actually, their name was Meesing.
Uh-huh.
And they believe that the reason he's so hard to capture on camera and everything is he can walk into and out of the world. And that's why it's hard to find his dwelling places.
Shapeshifter? Would you call that shapeshifting?
I don't think Meesing was a shapeshifter. But I'm not saying they didn't have shapeshifters in their tradition, but he wasn't one of them.
Wow. Interesting. Now, all right, I heard that the Maiden Creek was named that because the Indian maidens would paddle down the Maiden Creek in the spring, stop in Virginville, put on their makeup, and
I don't know who made that one up. I don't know who made that one up.
Continue on to Lake Onalani, which means deflowered Indian maiden. But I don't know if any of that's true.
I was told that it was originally called the Little Sister of the Schuylkill in Lenape language, and then they misinterpreted that to mean virgin.
Oh, interesting. All right. Now, we all love wildlife, right? So let's say goodbye, and what do we say, Lois? God bless America, right?
Okay. God bless America.
The land.
Have a good evening.
Very nice.
Thank you, Matt.